Serious, police of Reddit. Who was the worst criminal you've ever had to detain? What did they do? How did you feel once they'd been arrested? My worst was a reopens to a home for attempted suicide with the individual still armed with a knife. When we arrived, the suspect was walking down the side of the road at 3 a.m. covered in blood from having cut himself over most of his body with moderate to deep cuts he was covered. While we were standing around ordering him to drop the knife, he stood like a statue, not saying anything but staring. This guy was a towering 6 feet 5 220 pound man who looked at me, a 6 feet 160 pound 22 year old, and said, "I'm going to take your gun and shoot him," referring to my FTO at the time, who was similarly built to me. I deployed a taser, which did nothing but anger him. My FTO deployed his, which brought him down. Trying to handcuff a man covered in blood is terrifying. All the blood-borne diseases you can contract. He was transported to the hospital for his self-inflicted wounds. Upon further investigation, this guy had been luring cats and dogs to him, which he would end up killing and skinning. In this guy's shed, he had a harvesting room where he would turn the pelts of these animals into clothing. You name it, this guy had made it. The entire thing reminded me of some horror movie with a stench you could not stomach. That was my first week as a sworn officer. I turned 21 3 days before graduating the academy. I've been on now for a year or so, and that is the only guy I have ever met I believe could have taken my weapon and killed me. He later was declared mentally competent and charged. He as well was not suicidal but angry because he messed up on one of his creations. Oh my god, this is my biggest fear, that I'll be lumped in with people like this guy. I collect skulls from definitely already dead animals, and if I ever see roadkill, I'd be tempted to try to tan the hide, but certainly not of an obvious pet. Goddamn, what a psychotic, evil person. I honestly feel that the majority of the people I arrest aren't bad people and aren't criminals, per se. That being said, there are a couple dozen arrests that stand out in my mind. One in particular sticks out, not necessarily the worst, just one that sticks out the most. The suspect was approximately 40-ish, had a 15-year-old daughter, was a methamphetamine addict, lived in complete squalor. They get evicted and daughter gets taken into state custody. After a year of counseling, finally discloses that her father would inject her with methamphetamine and violate her. Therapist comes to us and we bring her in for an interview. This girl, I believe may have been 17 by now, is no girl. She is intelligent, articulate, and lived well beyond her years. She details in remarkable detail how one night her father injects methamphetamine into right forearm. This happened several times. One night he is extremely high, gets her high. As she is walking into the kitchen, he pins her against the wall and violates her. This begins to happen on a regular basis. Suspect eventually convinces daughter to start bringing friends home. Suspect injects friends with methamphetamine and violates them as well. Daughter continues to bring different friends home so the dad will violate the friends rather than her. Eventually, when they get evicted, father kicks daughter to the curb and two of daughter's friends go live out of dad's car in a nearby park. While these kinds of things happen all the time, it was the victim that struck me. When asked why she didn't tell someone, she replied, "The first time it happened when he pinned me against the wall, all I could remember thinking over and over, this is my life now. This is my life now. I will remember those words for the rest of my life, as clear as they were said to me." I can still hear the inflection and tone in her voice. About 8 months later, I ran into one of the other victims, the daughter's friend. After dad was evicted, he lived out of his car with her. She was 15-ish at the time. Initially, she was going to cooperate in prosecution. However, disappeared. She's 18-19 now. When I last saw her, I didn't recognize her until I saw her identification. H. Methamphetamine in the streets have destroyed her. She won't be alive much longer. This is my life now. I can only imagine how utterly chilling it must have been to see her recall that hopelessness. I hope she is doing alright now. Guy killed his girlfriend's baby by wrapping a towel around his neck and swung him around. On way to jail, he kept saying, "Real talk, bruh, I didn't kill that baby." He is presently serving 20 plus years. Kid had a broken neck and multiple skull fractures. Dang. I didn't get very far before realizing I have to get out of here. Thank you for doing what you do. A fellow who physically shamed a number of his preteen daughter's friends. He'd have her invite them over for movies and such, then drug their son and violates them. We never figured out exactly how many girls he violated, but we were able to prove up 28 counts. The arrest was not particularly satisfying. Having to be near him and listen to his diatribe made me feel unclean. His conviction and subsequent long sentence made me feel like being a cop was worth it at least 1% of the time. Arrested a doctor for carnally battering female patients. I've had partners of mine arrest even more awful people, like diddlers, but this man I actually arrested. He would only target his female clients who were mental health patients, so that many of their claims were overlooked due to their existing bipolar disorders or depression. He was a pose and his wife sat next to him the entire trial. True love, right? He lost his medical license, but we lost the case due to almost half of his victims refusing to testify and his high dollar, very educated attorney. That reminds me of the time I was given a Ladabits exam in a mental hospital, for some reason. The doctor did the exam with the nurse there, then they went out, then the doctor came back, without the nurse. He smirked at me and finger fricked me a few times. I just stared at him, terrified, thinking nobody will ever believe me. I'm supposed to be crazy. I've been in the police for nearly 2 years now. I was working a late shift on Christmas Eve, which is usually a matter of holding the fort and counting down the clock until the end of shift. We get a call. Sudden death. An elderly gentleman. A shame certainly, but nothing more than assumed routine. Inspecting the body for signs of trauma and calling the undertakers to remove the deceased. We get there and go in. The gentleman is lying on his sofa, with a duvet covering him. I perform the usual inspection of the house. Looking for anything out of place or suspicious. Not that it'd be easy, the house was like your over-the-top hoarder's palace. After some inquiries, it became apparent that the gentleman had lost the use of his legs many years before and lived downstairs, relying on his daughter to care for him utterly. We have to inspect the body for any signs of trauma or suspicious marks prior to calling the undertaker, so that we are sure that there is nothing untoward in relation to the death. We lifted off the duvet, as only his head was showing. And I was rather taken aback and stunned. The main images, having studied history at university, that came to mind was the pictures from the liberation of the concentration camps, emaciated and starved corpses. This man had been dead for no more than 4 to 5 hours, yet he was all skin and bones. He relied on his daughter to care for him, and he clearly had not been. He lay there, in his own filth, wasting away without anyone properly looking after him. It was utterly despicable. Death has a very distinct smell. It clings to your uniform and your body. I finished my shift in the early hours of the morning, went home and tried to sleep. I couldn't. I just lay there, eyes wide open, the man's body and his haunting stare taking centerpiece in my thoughts. In the end, I thought, frick it, I'm not going to sleep at this rate. I got in my car and drove the 100 miles to my parents to spend Christmas Day with them. To end on a slightly more humorous note, whilst opening one of the doors in the house, a cat jumped out of the darkness at me and I absolutely crap myself, nearly tumbled down the stairs with a shrill yelp. Sorry for the long post. I once arrested a deranged woman. Somehow got involved in a big fight that started with teenage girls. It blew up and was a full-on battle royal. The crazy lady was HIV positive and decided to start biting everyone in the fight. When I pull up, I hear her screaming, "I hope all of you catch it." Surprisingly, she only got 5 years for felony reckless conduct. We got a call for a home invasion. 3 guys kicked down the front door with Tech 9 machine pistols and put everyone on the ground. However, one of the sons, who lived at the house, was able to escape out the back. He ran to the neighbors and called 911. Once the home invaders took their loot, they escaped to a yellow 90s mode Ford Mustang. The son saw all this and got into his car. He starts to follow the crew as they make their getaway while still on the phone with 911. While the bad guys see this and start shooting at the son, who promptly backs off and loses sight of the guy. While responding to the call, my sergeant spots their car. Don't be an idiot and drive a unique vehicle at midnight. A small car chase follows until the bad guys crash into an abandoned business. 3 guys bail from the car. Good for both of us was they left their weapons inside the car. I'm there during all of this. We see one guy in a fenced commercial yard. He is stripping off his body armor and throwing down his C. I jump the fence and confront him at gunpoint. He freezes and you can see the gears in his head start working. He decides to give up and we detain him. Probably helped that a canine officer was right behind me. Other officers continue the search and find another guy inside a large trash can. The guy refuses to come out, so they kick over the can. Right as they kick over the can, they release a dog who bites him on the top of the head. We never found the third guy. Back to my guy now. Since there were still outstanding suspects, I kept him in the yard and was checking my surroundings until I could get bolt cutters to get out. He sneaks a phone call in by reaching into his front pocket and tells someone goodbye. I finally get him into a patrol car and read him Miranda. The guy invokes and stays silent. What was weird was how calm he was. He had a 1,000-yard stare and didn't appear to have a care in the world. He has a monotone voice that just seeped creepiness. The detectives finally arrived and give me the scoop on him. Apparently he is a cartel hitman. He was in the States doing work when his girlfriend threatened to snitch. He took her out at a dessert, bound her up, then burned her alive. He was also a suspect in several other murders in town. We eventually go to trial. He gets convicted and is currently serving 67 years. The other guy we caught was going to go to trial. However, he saw the outcome and decided to take a plea for 25 years. TLDR. Arrested and chased a cartel hitman who was also a serial kill. Rather have good police come late to a party than never come at all. I arrested a 20-year-old man for having a physical relationship with a 12-year-old girl. This is nothing too uncommon, but this one male was particularly evil. He had done it before, but we couldn't prove it or identify the victims. He thought he was okay because she loved him. He gave me access to his phones, and in reading the texts I almost puked. He was a master manipulator with these children, manipulating them into loving him, losing their virginity to him, then he would move on. He had hundreds of photos of many different girls on his phone, and it was very easy to determine how young they were. The worst part was his selfishness and lack of concern for what he had done, even admitting he knew it was wrong. There's an indescribable feeling in trying to relate to this guy in order to get statements and confessions. Worse also, was my trainee who had a daughter around the same age as the victim. He had a lot of trouble with this case. Then there's the terrible feeling when the victim blames you for putting their boyfriend in jail. The parents, though, were very appreciative. In the end, there was a sadness and terror in the case I was happy to be done with. But putting him in jail was satisfying. I'm still new in my career. 6 years. Worst I've had thus far would be probably a DUI driver resulting in a fatal traffic collision. I work traffic, so DUI arrests and incidents are very normal for me. One that sticks out in particular was a wrong-way DUI driver. 2 dead and 1 near dead. The wrong-way driver walked away and had the worst attitude, acting as if he was a victim and just a snotty overeducated butthole altogether. Definitely have to bite your lip and maintain professionalism in cases like those. 90% of DUI drivers that end up hurting or killing innocent parties seem to act like their crap don't stink as soon as the police show up. More often than not, they just berate us and talk crap. And always throwing out the "don't you have anything better to do?" There are murderers and rapists out there, and you're doing this type of talk. Maybe it's a nervous defense mechanism, but it certainly isn't as good one. You could just say, "I'm currently dealing with a murder, you moron." I arrested a 22-year-old guy who solicited over 400 girls over the internet. All but one or two were under 18. The majority were 13 to 15. He would tell them he was a modeling agent and solicit nudes. Once he received the nude photos, he would exploit the girls for fricking. He received photos from 10 or so girls. A couple of them fell for the trick and ended up participating in various physical acts in the exchange for deleting the photos, which he never did. His youngest victim was 13 years old, though she said she was a willing participant. One victim was tricked into several physical acts on several occasions. In instant messages with the 13-year-old victim, he asked if her 10-year-old sister would perform fellatio on him at the same time as the 13-year-old. He also asked the 13-year-old if she knew of any girls 8 years old to 15 years old who would participate in physical acts. He expressed little to no remorse and left a pregnant fiancé behind as he went to prison for 22 years. This guy and his wife start fighting in their apartment in South Los Angeles. It escalated into the guy picking up the 5-month-old baby and charging at the wall with the baby's head as a battering ram. He then threw the infant out of the third floor window. As I sat in the front of my police car with this guy cuffed in the back seat, all I could think about was a Pulp Fiction type turn around and put a hole in his head so it would ever happen again. It was very early in my career and made me think about whether I could handle 25-30 years of these kinds of things and what kind of person it would turn me into. The child actually survived and the man convicted. I'd put this incident away in a little sealed box in my head and forgotten about it until seeing this thread. Now I'm sweating and angry again. Some additional info as I've sat and thought about this. I know that the baby had a fractured skull and they were concerned about brain damage and the neck spine. I know that the child survived, but I never followed up because I completely put this out of my head and until the thread popped up. You could say that I'd completely forgotten about it. The best I can recall was that the guy got 18 years prison. Thanks for all the concern and support. I'm okay, but just for good measure I might have a chat with the depth psychologist about it. It's a big city. Bad things happen and as the hydraulic press channel would say, we must deal with it. Some things get to you more than others, but for the most part we learn how to deal with it and not take it home with us at the end of the day. I've been on 23 years with a few more to go yet. With all I've seen and done, I have one rule that I'll live and work by: treat everyone as well as they will let you treat them. It has served me well. The baby survived a three-floor drop. Dang tough baby. Police officer. Few years back, I got called to a priority job. Debauchery in progress. 2 a.m. Work in a country with unarmed police. Neighbors hear a girl screaming and banging and crashing from the neighboring unit. I work in a small town. The only backup was 20 minutes away dealing with something else. I had to go. No one else around. I arrive and start walking up the driveway. All is quiet. A male comes out from down the side of the neighboring unit. The one that called. Asks me, "What do you want?" I recognize the male as a child diddler. Ask him why he was down the side of the unit. "I live here." I knew he didn't. Local knowledge. "All good. What's your name?" "Get fricked. I don't have to tell you." "Technically true. Why are you down the side of that person's unit?" "No answer." "Tell male he's under arrest for trespass." "No, I'm not." "Put your hands behind your back." "Bring it on then, see." I pepper spray him and deal to him with my maglite torch. He puts up a half-assed fight. I quickly get him on the ground. Arrested, cuffed, and dragged down to my patrol car, crying like a bee. Male has spent most of his life in prison for various debauchery eyes and child physical shaming. Get some pee-week sentence, 5 years or something. Turns out, he had gotten drunk and walked to his partner's dog's house and tried to violate her while she was asleep in a room with her baby. Only reason he didn't was because he was too drunk to get an erection. Frustrated, he beat her up instead, told her if she screamed, he'd kill her and the baby. I only wish I had beaten him harder when I had a chance. Freaking trash of society, and then cried like a little girl after getting caught. Sometimes I don't know what to think of the world when I read some of these stuff. Cop here. The worst criminal that I had charges on had physically shamed his 2-year-old sister and had multiple pictures on his phone of the act. It was indescribable. I've arrested someone on a warrant for a double murder before. I also pulled a guy over who had a warrant out of Oklahoma for, and I quote, "aggravated forcible debaucheries of a victim under 12 inches that Oklahoma wouldn't extradite on." I spent 15 minutes confirming and having my dispatch call theirs and whatnot before I had to let him go. One of the hardest things I've had to do so far. That's all that comes to mind now. Sorry for a lack of explanation. The people below are correct. Oklahoma wouldn't extradite means they won't coordinate his return to the state. Believe it or not, the local county pays for his travel until he is outside my state. Then okay, the marshals takes over. However, the lack of extradition is also an abandonment of jurisdiction. So if I took him into custody on the warrant, it would be an unlawful arrest because Oklahoma wouldn't be able to prosecute based off of the relinquishment of jurisdiction. I didn't do the actual arresting, but I spent several months supervising Kristen Berry in custody after she and her husband, Joseph Walsh, were arrested for killing their infant son, Chance. Her husband beat Chance during a drug bender while she watched and complained they would get caught, saying "you're gonna freaking kill him" and recording audio of the incident on her phone in case they were caught. Her husband shoved a baby wipe down Chance's throat where it got stuck and he started to choke. to get it out, they pried his jaw open with pliers, breaking it and tearing out Chance's little tongue. When they finally retrieved the wipe from his throat, they left him to slowly die of his injuries in his crib. Kristen posted a Facebook message the day after Chance died saying how she was excited for their first family vaca. She never called 911. She said she didn't want to lose both people she loved in the same day. They left Chance to decompose for several days. When the smell overwhelmed them, they wrapped him in garbage bags and put him in a closet for several more days. Then, they buried him in a trash pile near a homeless camp and took off to start a new life together like Bonnie and Clyde. While in jail she was insufferable. She talked endlessly about how much money she was getting in support and bragged about how much commissary she could buy. She cried during NA meetings about how her son was murdered by her husband and then turned around after the civilian meeting leaders left and talked about how Joseph is the love of her life and she'll never stop loving him. She was quick to become angry over little things and routinely tried to either intimidate or impress other inmates with the severity of her crime. She asked me to print a picture of her son so she could have a picture to take to prison with her. She also asked me to look up publisher information so she could write a book about her experience. She is absolutely the worst person I have ever encountered and I had the hardest time of my professional career dealing with her pure sociopathic tendencies. She was not an abused wife who was conditioned not to cross her violent husband. She gave her first child away at a Denny's. Her second died after developing an infection that no medical care was sought for. And she helped brutally kill her third child. She deserves the death penalty and it's a shame she won't get it. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Bye for now.